today with the Hong Kong Privacy Commissioner. So I sit on the board of the Hong Kong Direct Marketing Association, and we got together as a group of concerned marketeers to talk about what he's doing and what he's not doing to support the industry as a whole and what's happening all around the Octopus debacle and the media reaction to it and the government reaction to it, to an issue that really should be a non-issue. And that's what the meeting was today.
So who knows the name of the current Privacy Commissioner? Put your hand up. Is it Roderick or is it Alan? If it's Roderick, put your hand up. If it's Alan, put your hand up. God, you're all bloody useless. You're supposed to be experts in the internet. It's Alan Chiang. Roderick Wu was the previous commissioner, who's a very verbal character, and was going to come tonight, but Charles scared him away.
He sent our email last night. Did you get that? Yeah, he just got back from vacation. He's too happy being out of the job.
He said that he's staying away from email, which is understandable. But he will be speaking at AmCham on the 1st of September, so if you want to hear the old version, talk to him. So anyway, Dom, so you were meeting with Alan. What's going on? What's happening in Hong Kong with data? Where are we? What's about to happen? Tell me more.
So we have a big issue at the moment, and we're here as, I think, internet marketers, but what we have to think about is that we're part of something bigger called the direct marketing industry. And that's what the HKDMA represents, is the direct marketing industry. And we have an industry in Hong Kong that's probably 3% of the GDP, about 31 billion Hong Kong dollars, employs about 140,000 people. And since the Octopus issue has come to the press, people in the direct marketing industry have been losing their jobs. Just at one call center in Hong Kong last week, 140 people were made redundant because of a letter that was sent out by the Privacy Commissioner to members of the direct marketing community saying that they have to make sure that all of the things they do as a direct marketing practitioner follow the basic principles of the Hong Kong Privacy Data Ordinance. And so what this has done is made the banks, insurance companies, any company that is legally operating in direct marketing, that is renting personal data, that has permission to rent data, questioning what they're doing internally. Not at the marketing level where you have the marketing director, but at the level of the CEO. And so what that has done is caused a knee-jerk reaction. And so I think if any of you are any Citibank customers or DBS customers, you would have likely got an email this week telling you that all direct marketing activities that involve your personal data being given to selected partners is stopping. And so what that has done has caused the call centers, the direct marketing houses, perhaps even ad agencies to have to reassess what they're doing for some of their clients around direct marketing. So while we're not necessarily seeing the impact in the internet industry yet, the follow-on into the agency world, the creative agency world, is only around the corner. And so the process that's been going through at the moment is that the Privacy Commissioner, who's only been in the job 1 month, who sat in his seat, an Octopus fell in his lap, literally on that first day, is in a position where he could likely change the entire direct marketing landscape of Hong Kong.
Interesting. So any of you guys been affected by this issue that Dom brings up? Anybody doing any direct marketing here? ADMA? Mike? HSBC? How's HSBC reacting to this? No comment. No comment, HSBC. Apparently in the PR world, that's the worst thing to say. Anyway.
That's why the MD lost her job at Octopus.
Well, I don't think she said no comment. She said too much.
So tell us, just for those of you who don't know, what happened with the MTR, Charles, that you think
Octopus.
You think hit the wrong...
Sorry, the Octopus, right, situation? Right. I believe what happened was it came to light a couple of months ago that they have been renting. Okay, I was going to say sell, but Dom corrected me that it should be renting information from their users to selected parties like magazine companies or insurance companies. That's where they got most of the money from, and so on, to do direct marketing. Typically, I think people would get solicited through the phone for the information that they got from through Octopus. And the controversy was that, of course, a lot of people immediately thought about all the possible implications from a average citizen's point of view, nothing to do with the industry, assuming that they don't really care or have thought about how these people might be losing their jobs and so on. But I'm feeling violated. You know, I got somebody who is storing a lot of my data, maybe even where I've been traveling and what I've been buying, condoms from Watson or whatever, and all these informations are being passed to somebody. Maybe it hasn't, but I'm feeling violated. Secondly, I think a lot of people feel that they felt that somebody is selling, or selling, if that's the wrong word, renting my stuff to other people and making money from it. And when it came to light that actually Octopus made $44 million Hong Kong, you know, you could say it's a lot of money, you could say it's very little money. Actually, they haven't finished with the accounting, it might be more than that in the end, but at least they've disclosed that they have made at least $44 million. And then there's obvious political pressure from the legislative party saying that, oh, how are you going to return that money to the public? And then Octopus, in the end, they say that I'm going to give that $44 million to community chest. And then people start to say, why are you not giving it back to me? Or waiving my deposit when I get my Octopus card, because that actually adds up to also a lot of money. So anyway, it's a knee-jerk reaction from the politicians. All of a sudden, I have to say that at the end of last year, when the PDPO, the Personal Data and Privacy Ordinance, was going through consultation, none of these legislators really cared so much at the time looking at the details and so on. And all of a sudden, right now, they all got interested because of Octopus. But one final word, the problem with Octopus very much is also because of the way that they handle it, and not necessarily just because of the renting or giving out of data, because everybody knows that it happens all the time. But the problem is, when Prudence Chan was confronted by the press and legislators about it, at first she denies that they ever did anything like that. And then it's like what we call in Chinese greasing toothpaste. Every time...
Can you say that in Chinese? For Didier's?
Greasing toothpaste.
No, in Chinese.
In Cantonese.
Greasing toothpaste.
Yeah. So every time I find out a little bit more, from a risk management point of view, it's actually one of the worst things, because I'd rather disclose everything to you and say, okay, I'm sorry. But now every time you say a bit more, and then I have to say, oh, sorry, last time I didn't have all the information. Oh, you were the CEO. So that's also why a lot of people get really upset.
So did BP grease their toothpaste? Mm-hmm. BP, the oil company, they greased a fuck a lot of toothpaste.
Yeah. It's probably a PR mistake that a lot of people make.
So who's feeling violated by Octopus? Who gave their data to Octopus?
Who knows?
Three of you. Are you feeling violated? You are.
Did you sign up to the rewards program willingly? Did you read the not-so-small print?
Not so small, very small.
It was not small. If you go to the website,
okay.
It was 12 font type.
Okay, so I've got a question. I was listening to a podcast this morning, and I heard about Facebook has also got a union. So a bit like the Octopus users saying, give me back my money. Apparently there's a union. Have any of you joined this on Facebook? Where you can join the Facebook union, and every time they sell your data or rent your data, you get a cut of that's the goal, right? You get a cut of the money that Mark Zuckerberg uses to buy that really naff t-shirt he wears.
Union? Facebook?
No, an independent bloke out of Manchester in the UK.
So they told you that they're going to rent your data, and then they tell you that you're going to get a share out of it.
No, their mission...
Their mission?
...is to say to Facebook, you're making money out of my data, out of my photographs, out of my news sharing. I want a cut of that.
Do you know who runs that union? Is it somebody who just wants to collect 50 million people's information? Anyway, I mean, yeah.
He was called Charles Mock 1952, and he had some really weird email address in Romania. Anyway, so I thought it was interesting, because it's telling me that people are moving into this level of awareness. So I think that the point of Octopus is awareness of data. So what do you think is the problem? Is the problem that privacy is something that we don't understand or we don't care about? I mean, I find it fascinating. Mark Zuckerberg stands up, he talks about data privacy, and 2 weeks later he's got another 100 million people on Facebook. Okay, it doesn't happen in that time, but... So do people know what privacy is? Do they really care about it? Maybe you can start on that one.
So I think we bring it back to Hong Kong, and we could just ask you guys here a very simple question. As marketers, how many of you have actually taken the effort to read the privacy ordinance? It's not that long. How many of you?
Okay. Three.
So
the ordinance or the guidelines?
Okay, the guidelines. That's the guidelines then. Okay, I'll be specific. The guidelines. Okay. So that's as marketers. Now, as consumers, how many of the 7.whatever million population here do you think have taken the effort from a consumer perspective to understand, one, what their rights are when people collect their data, and then two, what are the obligations of the marketers and what can the marketers do with the data? That is a fundamental problem we have in Hong Kong. And it's a fundamental problem that's driven by an apathy, perhaps, with the Privacy Commissioner's Office to actually educate the general public. And that's one of the things that we're pushing very hard, is consumers need to be educated.
And no money.
Yeah, well, it doesn't take money. There are plenty of SMEs out there that market ideas with very little money. And as a government quango, a funded organization, you can do that. And the problem is, when consumers sign up to Octopus, it's stated very clearly that we will share your data with selected marketing partners to bring you offers that we deem of value to you. And that's the whole point of a rewards program. But consumers didn't take really the initiative to read what was put in front of them. And so that's why perhaps you feel violated. Did you get any offers from Octopus that are of value, that you actually used?
But she doesn't know it comes from Octopus. Yeah. That's the problem, right?
Well, yeah, because the reward's a really great program. But I didn't give them permission to sell my data.
Well, you did. In the fine print, yeah, you did.
Alright, so what is the solution, right? So basically, nobody cares or doesn't read the details. Yeah. So that's telling me that somebody needs to do some education.
And I think
is the education going to come in the form of YouTube videos or officials standing up in front of people or this lot talking to their clients? Who's going to educate the public to know what it's all about? Because at the moment there's this kind of grey area that's causing confusion, right? I mean, in the Chinese press, how's it coming across? Is it like
I think the problem that we face, I definitely agree, education, there needs to be more education. But the problem also is that people over the last 10, 15, 20 years, we have been a lot more so-called privacy aware than before. Everybody feels that I have more rights to my own information, and partly it's also because of the threats that are being uncovered, the problems that are being uncovered. You know, people, local, international. You know, people losing data and so on. You know, just like the Octopus situation actually in Hong Kong. I look at it as the stage two. The stage one was, remember a year or two ago, when the hospital authority and other organizations they actually came out voluntarily. Imagine those who didn't tell you about it. These public organizations, because they are public organizations, they felt they're obliged to tell you that really I lost the stuff. And they were losing USB drives, they were losing hard disks, and so on, of patients' data. And that actually got a lot of people aware to the stage one, because that was losing data that were actually never found. Nobody really found them and were found to be using them. Okay, at least nobody found, nobody said that it was has been found, it hasn't been uncovered. Nobody has been discovered that happened. But now we're on to stage two, that people are all of a sudden, average people, they definitely have they have not read the ordinances and the guidelines and so on. They found that, actually, I was only told, I didn't read, obviously, nobody reads those fine prints. I mean, we all admit, even when we signed up to Google or signed up to Gmail, we never read any of those stuff. And then they felt I'm getting all these goodies because you wanted me to use your service, right? And now I'm finding out that actually you're making money out of out of my data, and they felt, again, violated. Now, whether or not this is an issue of the merchants or the Octopus and the like being, you know, they haven't been forthcoming or they're trying to trap people, that's another issue. You know, the prints, whether or not the prints are big enough and so on. But in fact, people would never really, they would never read that stuff anyway, right? So I think what we're seeing right now is that there's a growing sense of the importance of privacy, but everybody is grappling about what to do with your own privacy. Facebook is a good example. I mean, the Facebook and Google, even Eric Schmidt came out a couple of weeks ago to say, you know, the sort of things like, you know, basically translate, I mean, paraphrasing, it would be something like, forget it, there's no more privacy. It's not like the old days anymore, right? And to different people, actually the point privacy means very different stuff. What does it mean by privacy? What does it mean to you, privacy? What does it mean?
Seeing me naked.
Okay.
I tell you what privacy means. Privacy means to me...
That's the Edison Chan definition.
Now, you know what privacy means to me? It's somebody who's seen a picture of my son on Facebook coming up to me and saying, your son's really handsome.
That's not a compliment, that's actually...
Privacy. No, because they stood a bit too close to me, and it was a man. So, it was worrying. So anyway, it seems to me that what's happening... You have a point?
I think the point I want to make is, while Octopus has been really pulled through the ringer over this in the past 2 weeks, everything that Octopus has been doing has been going on for the past 30, 40 years. It has been happening every day in almost every country that has a developed marketing infrastructure. Data has been shared. And these activities are generally backed up by watertight contracts that say, okay, we're going to use the data for one time and we're going to promote our services. What's making this issue more and more abrasive to people at the moment, I think, is because of Facebook. Because we're talking about different kinds of privacy. There's only certain information you can garner from what you sign up to Octopus or an American Express card with. But when you flip that to information that's very detailed, very personal about your life, that's when people are now starting to get really agitated. But again, it goes to education. If you put something up about how drunk you got on your last holiday, or you put pictures of your son up, you're putting them on the internet, which is a public location. So you also have to understand as a user that people can come in and look at that. Perhaps they're not your friend and you put it available to everybody. So again, it's about the education.
But what you're saying is it's been happening for the last 30, 40 years. So I compare it to Lehman Brothers issue in Hong Kong, right? Bankers have been making money hand over fist by selling products that don't exist for the last 30, 40 years. And the you know, the finance world collapses and suddenly everybody goes, woo! And there's big protests in Hong Kong about Lehman's. And you know, you could say it was in the small print, we're selling you a product that actually doesn't exist. So, but they still fought for it. So it seems to me we're in a kind of data gate kind of situation, right? Where suddenly people are saying, data gate. Gate. I've named Adeline, I've TM, data gate, trademark. So are we in a situation where, you know, it's awareness, right? When I invest money and somebody in a bank tells me this is a really good product, it's called, you know, CD or whatever. Okay, what the fuck does that stand for? Oh, it doesn't matter, it just gives you 20% return. Sign this. Yeah, sure. Same thing with data, right? I mean, you know, why suddenly people are aware of it, right? So what you're saying is we need to do something about it. So do you think the right vehicle to do this is an organization, a government? Do you think it requires Donald Jang or Alan Chang or you? Or who does it require to turn this around? Does it require the government or the community?
In my personal philosophy is I want, in general, as little government intervention as possible, because I basically, for me personally, I don't trust the government that much.
Whichever. Are you talking about this one or the one
I'm
across the border?
Across the border, up north. It could be up north or American government or any government. A government given the power is, you know, somebody I wouldn't totally trust. But I think the problem right now, Dom had made a very good point about privacy. That's why I asked people how you define privacy. What Napoleon talked about, you know, information, your intimate details, what you do, what you like, and so on Facebook. Actually, arguably, I would argue that actually it isn't even protected by law in Hong Kong. Because remember, it is not a privacy law per se, it's called a Personal Data Record, Privacy Ordinance. So what it regulates on is actually personal data, which is sort of defined as the data that can identify you. So your ID card number, your credit card number, or your name and address, and things like that. Even your picture. And there was a case like this a few years ago. Some magazine, some gossip little, you know, all those Hong Kong magazines, somehow took pictures of people on the street and say, oh, this woman really dressed like a trash lady or whatever. And those, some of those people actually took up a case against to the privacy commissioner and said that they're violating my privacy by printing my picture on there. And finally, that case was actually thrown out. What I think is private to me doesn't mean that it is governed by the law. So that's why Dom is very right about the need to educate people about what the law really does for you and doesn't do for you. But I think people really are gaining a different sense about privacy and my right. You know, people, like it or not, people, especially with the internet, people feel that they have a lot more right now than they did before. They seem to know a lot more than they did before. And so now they're saying, I don't have informed consent. I signed the consent document, but sorry, I really didn't read it. But I was not informed. You should tell me in my face. That's partly what was happening with the Lehman Brothers mini bond situation as well, right? They all signed the paper, but they didn't read it. And now they're saying that you didn't tell me. You should tell me very explicitly. You should tell me that it's just like your cigarette packs, that if anyone smokes, you know, tell you that you're going to get cancer, right? You have to tell me. And this is not like an informed, very well informed consent. I cannot deny that. I know it. So that's the problem. People are demanding that right more than the last 34 years that people
what do you think is gonna
giving
happen?
Up the consent.
You mentioned one and two. What happens in three?
What three?
You had phase one.
Oh.
Phase two.
I
phase
don't know.
One was a hospital.
Phase three might be Facebook and the social media. You know, all these information being. The interesting situation is we're going in two or three or at least two different directions. In a way, the technology is taking us where, you know, like Google and Facebook are telling us there's no privacy anymore. But on the other hand, people are beginning to feel that I want to guard my privacy more than I did before. Now, how do you reconcile between that two situations?
So there's a very good question that was sent in. Jennifer, are you here, Jennifer? Do you want to ask the question that you sent me earlier? Come and ask the question. Jennifer has a rather interesting profile on Facebook.
Sorry. My nickname is Bunny, and my Twitter name is BunnyBlogsHK. But anyway, I'm Director of BizDev for Rackspace in Hong Kong, and my question was, are we moving towards paying a premium for layers of privacy filters, info removal, like Reputation Defender? I mean, is that going to be the worst case scenario later, that we're going to have to pay to erect these filters to protect ourselves? Will that be a
pay to protect your privacy?
Yes. And I mean, Reputation Defender removes your smears from the internet, like smear campaigns, bad things about yourself, you pay for that. But I'm saying, like, will normal people have to start paying for certain filters? Like, okay, I mean, I have filters on Facebook right now, but will I be paying filters to companies to protect certain layers of myself?
Does anybody in this room use Reputation Defender? Is anybody trying to hide anything on the internet?
I don't have any reputation to defend.
So I thought it was a really good question, because there's this whole talk on the internet now about net neutrality, right? The idea is the internet is the same for everybody, access is the same for everybody. So then I thought, okay, this question, what makes it interesting is, are we going to have to pay to be more private? So does that mean, you know, like barbed wire or bouncers or whatever? Does it get to the point where the more famous and the more people want to kind of like follow you, the more you're going to have to pay to be private on the internet?
No, because some people want a lot of people to know them, to follow them. I mean, that's exactly the what I was talking about. You know, I want, well, maybe not everybody, but some people want a lot of they want to share a lot of things on the internet, like through Facebook and so on. The definition, the concept of being a friend, who's a friend and who's not a friend, is very different from before. In a very contradictory way, they are also beginning to say that I want my things to be private. And actually, I don't think they know what they're talking about. I mean, the users.
But wait, Dom, so you're in a business, right? There's a lot of businesses out there. You're in a business where people are willingly... Excuse me. Shh. I've got your name. Matt. You're in a business that's all about data and profiling and sending people relevant offers. How much of your business is this going to blow over? Basically, tell me, do you think that it's getting to a point where people really are, they like the fact they're being sent email that says, you know, you went to Bali last year, we've got a special offer for you this year. Do people actually, are the benefits outweigh the negatives so much that I think people don't really give a toss?
I think they do. And if you look at, again, Hong Kong as an example, the Roderick, the former privacy commissioner, every 2 years the privacy commissioner releases a report. And the last 2 year report that he released as he was exiting showed that there were only 964 complaints to the privacy commissioner in 2 years about things that people were offended by. And of those 964, only a very small amount were about data privacy. A lot of them were irrelevant about service levels of what they got. Now, we've done our own research, and we've done this across the region, we've done it across the globe, and people want to receive relevant communications, whether it's through email, whether it's through traditional mail. They don't want things wasted. Their time is very precious. And so what you have to look at is, who are those groups of people? There are a bunch of people who are internet savvy, who are in a particular age bracket, who understand that if they give a little bit of data, they're going to get something back in return. It's a two-way relationship. But then you also have to look at the silver surfers, and you have to look at the younger generation, the young Facebook generation, the group of people who have said they're 13 years old, but they're not, the people who have gone past that bracket, who are 14 years old, the people that have 2,000 friends and they're 13 years old. They're posting stuff on the internet that, as Eric Schmidt said, it's going to come back and haunt them for the rest of their life.
But then they just change their name when they reach 18.
Exactly.
Right?
So is that
you'd be
really
Charlie Mack instead of Charles Mock.
So,
or Denise Powers.
But I go back to the same thing. It's about education. It shouldn't be about people having to think, good God, I now have to invest in a service that's going to protect my privacy. It should be the consumer should actually think, I'm entering into some kind of relationship, whether it's with an online service, whether it's a credit card company. What data do I want to give them? I should stop and think, no, I'm not going to post pictures of myself naked in Lang Kwai Fong on Facebook, because I know it's not the right thing to do, because that's going to come back. So people have to think before they then start thinking about paying for services. And if it's not a new thing. Who remembers PrivaSeek? PrivaSeek. Okay, 12...
That sounds really dirty. PrivaSeek sounds really dirty.
It was back in the dot-com boom day. It launched in about 98-99. It was a paid service where you could protect your online privacy.
Is that like names? There's a site called NAYMZ who pesters you and says, your reputation online is this. Does anybody know names? Who's pestered by names? Who's actually used names? I don't know.
So PrivaSeek went bust because I think it was perhaps too early. But what it was a place that you would put all the kind of information that you would give to a service online when you registered. And they managed it in one central location. And their aim was then to create a secure socket between their infrastructure and the likes of Facebook or a bank. And that information was passed back and forth as it was needed, but it was completely encrypted. Nobody could read the actual information, and it was decrypted through a key in a way that would make it usable by that organization, but nobody in that organization could ever view it. It never lasted. It lasted for about 2-3 years. It came to Hong Kong, I think in the year 2000, launched, was gone within 6 months. Maybe times are different. Maybe people would want that. But I don't think a general population that lives in Lai Chi Kok or Tuen Mun, wherever it is going to want to pay $10 a month to protect their privacy. So it goes back to education.
Okay, so let's take a question from Jay. Jay, are you here? Mate, you've got a question. Do you want to say it in person? It's a rather sophisticated question for a Canadian. Jay, come and ask this question. It's a really good question. Like the hairstyle. Jay, 100,000 followers on Twitter.
Woo!
Writing a book.
96.
You lost 6,000, you poor sod.
Actually, I lost more than that, but I've regained a bunch. But we're not here about me. I guess the question is the benefits of what Mark Zuckerberg calls radical transparency. The idea that the more of ourselves that we put out there, and that knowing that we just got to let go and have as much of us out there as possible, because from that, there will be benefits. From that, there will be things that come back to us. And I've experienced this myself on Twitter. I mean, certainly the more I share, the more that does come back. You know, does that ever outweigh what we're now realizing are the personal risks? From people who get stalked on Foursquare to, I don't know, just your information generally being sold off to every marketer in China.
Rented. From now on, when you talk about data, do not use the word sold. Use the word rented. Correct, Matt? You rent your data. Fox Networks rents your data to other people. It doesn't sell it, right?
That's correct. There's no change of title.
We don't sell it.
They rent. No change of title. Explain. Anyway, can you answer Jay's question, please, Charles? Radical, what was it? Radical transparency.
Radical transparency, whatever. Yes, personally, yes. I think we're doing that already. We're enjoying the benefits. And I think, personally for me, yes, I agree that this is a good thing. But the problem is, whenever you get, coming from a different point of view, when you are a social worker, when you are a teacher or concerned parent, you could blame them for not understanding it. But the fact is, there has been cases that are bad. Kids putting up whatever information and then whatever. I don't have to repeat those cases. So anytime when any of those things happen, people get scared. And politicians or government come in and try to see what they can do or regulate. That's the point that I think we need a balance. I don't deny that there are these kind of risks. And we can't, for the benefit of the whole healthy development of this media, I don't think it helps to simply deny the situation and say that, the benefit outweighs the risk and the...
Yeah, but you're all over the internet. You're on Twitter, you're on Sina, you have a blog, you're even on Wikipedia. You're on the Chinese Wikipedia, you're on the English Wikipedia. Do you have any privacy? Do you hide anything?
No, you can even find
my phone number. Radically open?
I am radically open because I have to. I'm a semi-public figure. I ran in election, so you could find my ID card numbers online.
Can I get any dirt on you online?
Sorry?
Any dirt? Can I dig up any dirt on you online?
Certainly. If somebody considered those to be dirt, yes, there must be my dirt online as well. But I have to say, adults or people like ourselves are different. We cannot deny that. That's the issue. I think we have to deal with these problems and try to find a balance. Education is a much used word, and sometimes people take it like you don't know how to deal with it, so you talk about education, but in reality, that's still needed. But I don't think we could apply the same standard of what somebody like me or Jay or Dom like us to say that it could apply to everyone, because they might think differently and they might be in a different mental or personal stage that they may be more dangerous, being targeted or young kids or whatever. There are dangers, so we cannot deny that. That's what I just want to say. I think that's why we need some education or actually in some ways actually some possible guidelines somewhere to prevent certain operators from doing certain things.
So Dom, you were a bit reluctant to get on Twitter, and then now you're on Twitter. So have you seen any benefits? Jay says he's got a lot of benefits. So you being a guy in the industry, You're out there at all these events, you're talking a lot, and now you're Dominic Powers on Twitter, and you're linking to all these really cool reports. Is it helping you or your business at all? Are the benefits outweighing, I mean, you're not talking about anything else that's private, but the benefits outweighing the what's the opposite, benefits? The non-benefit.
A very good question, because I was thinking about this at the weekend myself and how I separate things. And so Twitter, for me, I use it very much as a work tool to promote what we do as an organization. I don't use Facebook to do that. I use Facebook, for example, as a means to connect with friends or very close associates. And so you almost have separate personalities. I'm very businesslike on one, and on the other, it's very family orientated. It is pictures of the kids. It's, you know, pictures of the holidays or what you were doing. But none of that goes on Twitter because we use it as very much as a business channel. And yes, because we're in the industry, I think we do that. But you do have individuals out there, and there's a lot of them in the industry, there's a lot in Hong Kong, that their profiles are completely mixed. So it will be work things that go through, it will be personal things that go through. And I think that is where the danger is. It's about how they use it. So the benefit,
yeah, if you talk to people like Jay, he's like, no, Twitter's about being personal and, you know, it's who you are. And so a lot of the PR firms are recommending
42 characters.
Yeah, PR firms are saying, right, get on the web, be personal. Tell people who you are. Tell people the personality behind your company. Tell people the character behind the oil slick, whatever, right?
But you link out. You always link out from Twitter. It's just, as you know, it's quick. Then you link out to the place where you're going to do that in a lot more words.
I tell you what, let's take some questions from the floor. So you take this. All right, who's got a question?
Peter.
Yeah, no, he's a dodgy character, this one.
Do you think individuals should have the same ability that corporations do to ask for their data to be removed from websites with their own personal data? So if I decide that 5 years from now I want the pictures from my birthday party from last weekend taken off of Facebook because I've changed jobs, I've, you know, decided to join the government, and I don't want my past to follow me, corporations have the ability to say, this is my data, you must take it down. Should I have that ability with Facebook to say, please go remove this from anything that you've ever done?
Charles, you can answer that one, because I know you've got an opinion about this, right, to do with removing data off Facebook.
Yes, I think there should be such a right, but the problem is, again, and how enforceable it is, especially with the internet globally, you know, I don't know, Facebook moved its registration outside of the US, even if the US government decides to enforce such a thing, which I doubt they want, they would anyway. So that's the whole problem. And, you know, many of these problems we face on the internet is because, you know, it's such a global thing, and how much regulation can governments really put on unless corporations really feel that they have to do it.
But you mentioned earlier when we were talking about some Facebook pages or groups that were suddenly taken down in Hong Kong. You had some issues because Lee Kai-sing or somebody had some investment in Facebook, and suddenly these pages disappeared.
I think that's a different kind of issue. Actually, we're myself and some other people, we're actually working with Google and other people to work on this sort of issue, but more from a human rights angle. The issue is, in different countries, there is the problem of account deletion. For whatever reason, some people, especially political or other sort of activists, when they put up certain information, not just in local forums, but even sometimes on Facebook or the Gmail account and so on, mysteriously getting removed. A lot of times it might be due to people making complaints. And for the case of Facebook, there were a couple of anti-DAB local political party, June 4th memorial pages on Facebook that were suspended or removed without any explanation, possibly because somebody made a huge number of complaints over a short period of time, and it just reached that mysterious threshold that Facebook never tells you about. That's the problem with Facebook as well. They don't have, they have zero customer service. There's no one to answer the line. You send them an email, they don't get back to you. They don't feel that they have to do that. And if anyone targets me and want to send a whole number of complaints to Facebook and get my account deleted, they could do that. Actually, mine got suspended for a short period of time. I was lucky. Some people never get it back. And they get very frustrated because I collected, I have all these 2,000 or 500 friends, and all of a sudden I lost all of them. Who would make a backup of your Facebook friend? Anyway, so that's actually an issue with a lot of countries. There seem to be organized efforts in certain countries doing this against certain activists or dissidents and so on. So the thing is, we're talking to companies like Google, Yahoo, and so on, Microsoft, and so on, through Global Network Initiative. If you look up their website, it's an organization that look at those sort of issues, to try to set up some sort of mechanism to help them deal with it. In a way, they don't want to make, they don't want to see this sort of things happen either. But how? But they cannot deal with the, all kinds of complaints or inquiries. And so on. So how do we set up a system to prevent this sort of things happening? But unfortunately, Facebook has been in some of our conference calls, but Facebook really hasn't. They just listen. They haven't said anything. I don't think they want
to. So how about you, Tom? You don't work necessarily in social media, but if a company says, like, delete these accounts off your database, because you collect a lot of data, right? So are you working with companies to remove data?
So I think I'm actually first going to go back to the original question. Because the problem you have with that is extraterritoriality, which is every territory has their own laws and they can't apply those overseas. However, the problem goes to extraterritoriality, where every country has their own laws and they obviously can't enforce those overseas. And so while, as an example, when the Hong Kong government was shaping the unsolicited electronic messaging ordinance, the spam ordinance, they tried to apply some level of extraterritoriality to that by talking to other developed governments that they would work together to track down people that were sending spam. Now, to bring that back to your question, if Facebook was in Hong Kong, a registered Hong Kong company was set up in Hong Kong, if there was information that they had on you that you either knew about or didn't, you would have the legal right to have access to that. You would also have the legal right to ask them to delete it. But the problem is, it's not in Hong Kong, it's a global organization, and so that right really doesn't exist. And the key thing about that is if it's personally identifiable. So if it identifies you as an individual, so in Facebook that's whether it's a name or an email address that contains your full name, or it's a photograph that tags you as an individual, then you'd have the right. But unfortunately, in reality, you don't have that right.
Another question? Therein.
I might be the only one trying to understand this, but if I'd read the fine print, and actually understood those legal terms, what's the difference between renting and selling my data?
Great question. And this is a thing that the politicians, the privacy commissioner, and the press don't understand. When you sell a house, you exchange title. It physically becomes, under law, somebody else's property. When you rent a house, somebody has the right to use it. You have a contract in place which says, you can use this for a specific period of time. In the direct marketing world, there are contracts that, I've seen contracts that are 25 pages thick that The Economist, Incisive Media, and I've worked for both of them, would use that would say, okay, you're a marketing partner, you want to have access to my consumers. I will provide my list for one-time use for you to use for a marketing campaign. It is a rental agreement, and you will pay me a fixed fee or whatever it is to use it once. It's used once, and the legally binding contract enforces that. If you're working with a dodgy marketing partner, they will most likely get caught out because the lists are seeded, and they put people in it who they know, who if they see extra marketing campaigns come out, they can go to that partner and say, you've breached this contract. With Octopus, the data was never sold, it was rented. It was not given to those marketing organizations to keep forever. It was for one-time campaigns, be it call center, be it email, be whatever it is. And that's the difference.
The other difference is that once you're rented and you opt in to that other campaign, they own you as well.
Yeah, correct.
Right. Another question? Kinsey. better be juicy.
It's quite boring. I'm interested to know how the Hong Kong data privacy ordinance compares with other data privacy laws around the world.
So the great thing about the Hong Kong privacy data ordinance is it's actually very old. It was first put out in 1996. And what a lot of people don't know is that the government actually went to PricewaterhouseCoopers and said, can you look at all the privacy and data ordinances that exist around the world and create me one of the best? And so they worked with PwC, and there's actually a guy who still works for PwC here in Hong Kong who was part of that, who helped them formulate what that ordinance would look like.
Can the government hire that guy?
I think he should be the next privacy commissioner, because he understands the industry and understands the market, which is good. So the ordinance that exists today is 14, 15 years old. It is actually very, very good. It's very solid. It runs around six principles that can probably be brought down to three. And these are three that, as an organization, we've used for a long time. Notice, transparency, choice. If you're collecting data, tell people what you're going to do with it. Transparency, if you tell them you're going to do something, don't do 25 other things with it. And choice, give them the chance to access their data whenever they want it, and give them the choice to unsubscribe whenever. And that's basically what it can be boiled down to. So it's very clear, it's very transparent, it's very manageable, but just nobody takes the time to read it.
I would only add that I agree. The ordinance is actually a good ordinance, but the only issue is enforceability. And whether or not the privacy commissioner has the details, you know, whether or not this privacy commissioner, whoever he is, has the right and the tools to investigate, to launch an investigation, whether or not he has the resources to actually do it, which is a point that the last commissioner Roderick always complained about. He just said that there's too much things for him to do, and I don't even have one IT guy in my house, and I have all these internet issues. I don't even know what an IP address is, and I don't have money to hire anyone, things like that. So it's really in that sort of situation that the law, I agree, itself is very solid, and the principle really doesn't change that much. Your other question was how it compares with other jurisdictions. My understanding is, if you look around Asia, most of the countries in Asia do not have similar privacy ordinances that protect people at all. If I'm correct, this ordinance is sort of follows the sort of European mentality back when it was 15 or whatever years ago when it was first drafted. And of course, since then, the EU and so on has done possibly a lot more, maybe too much in Dong's mind. And of course, the Americans don't really have anything. You know, they really don't have anything.
Okay, so we have, sorry to cut you off, we have a question from the back here. Klaus, you go.
Yeah, my question is, do you guys think there's a chance for new companies like MyQ, for example, out of Singapore, social networks that are trying to address explicitly the ownership and control, or do you think that existing networks like Facebook can fix that?
Can you explain that? I don't understand that question. Do you understand that question?
Yeah.
So Facebook is a walled garden. You're more intelligent than me.
Facebook is a walled garden. It goes back to privacy that I was talking about earlier. Facebook is walled. The data you have, the data you give them, it's theirs to manage and hold. Other organizations like PrivacyCoop are trying to find ways that they can manage your personality, not just online, but offline as well. So be a central clearinghouse about what people can have in terms of information about you, whether it's an ID number.
Dom, could you speak louder? I can't hear you back here.
So Facebook is a walled garden, and so the information they hold about you, they only use themselves. And to be honest, even now, they don't even use it with their advertisers because the advertising is so irrelevant. But what these other organizations are trying to do is to give you a similar thing to like privacy, give you the ability to control your personality, your profile, who you are, whether it's online or whether it's offline. Now, whether those can succeed or not depends on the data users and the organizations that the data is shared with, because there has to be a mechanism, whether it's technology, whether it's policy driven, that controls that information flow. I don't think it can succeed. I think it still has to be driven by education, consumer education, and individuals understanding that the information they put online, the information they put on forms, is going to be stored somewhere and is going to be used. So I don't think they can succeed.
But even if you're talking, Turn
it on, Charles. I can't hear you.
Even if you're talking about Facebook being a walled garden, I don't think we're really just concerned about the Facebook itself. We're also, people should be concerned about also other people going in there and trying to become your friend or trying to lure you into adding my application, and then I get to know, I get access to your information. So it is a walled garden, but it's actually an open walled garden that anybody could go in and get information from other users.
But it's with a level of consent, because they have to say yes. Right. But whether it's informed consent
or understood consent.
All right, another question.
I'd like a clarification on the under the Privacy Data Protection Ordinance. The only penalty provisions are if you don't comply with the commissioner's order. In other words, there's no penalty for violating privacy.
So the Privacy Commissioner